And what a great God we serve. I ask you to please take your Bibles and turn with me to the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 14. 2 Chronicles chapter 14. We're going to be talking this morning about a national figure who brought political and religious reform to his nation by building a wall and building a military. Don't worry, it's not who you think. We're looking at King Asa this morning. King Asa, 2 Chronicles chapter 14. 2 Chronicles chapter 14. And when you find your place, we'll begin in verse 1. 2 Chronicles chapter 14. Abijah slept with his fathers, and they buried him in the city of David. And Asa, his son, reigned in his place. In his days, the land had rest for 10 years. And Asa did what was good and right in the eyes of the Lord his God. He took away the foreign altars and the high places and broke down the pillars and cut down the Asherim and commanded Judah to seek the Lord, the God of their fathers, and to keep the law and the commandment. He also took out of all the cities of Judah the high places and the incense altars, and the kingdom had rest under him. He built fortified cities in Judah, for the land had rest. He had no war in those years, for the Lord gave him peace. And he said to Judah, "Let us build these cities and surround them with walls and towers, gates and bars. The land is still ours because we have sought the Lord our God. We have sought him, and he has given us peace on every side." So they built and prospered, and Asa had an army of 300,000 from Judah, armed with large shields and spears, and 280,000 men from Benjamin that carried shields and drew bows. All these were mighty men of valor. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning in the precious name of Jesus, and we thank you for your word. We thank you for how great you are, and that we can serve you and worship you this morning. Father, we pray that you would speak to our hearts through your word, and let us hear it as it is, the word of God. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As I said this morning, we're going to be speaking about a king of Israel, of Judah, the southern kingdom, named King Asa. And we looked last week on King Abijah and the sermon that he preached as they were about to battle with the northern kingdom Israel, and how he told the king Jeroboam that God had chosen the line of David, and so that was the right line. He had chosen the Levites to be priests, so that was the right priesthood, and they needed to stop fighting against God. Well, Abijah has died, and now his son is reigning. Now, Abijah did some things good in the eyes of the Lord. He did some things that were good. This particular story we have in 2 Chronicles 13 was something that he did that was good. However, if you look in 2 Kings or 1 Kings, it'll tell you some other things that he did that was not good. King Asa, his son, for the most part, did good things in the eyes of the Lord. Now, as we'll probably see toward the end of his life, he did make a mistake. He did do something that was not pleasing, and it's recorded in the scriptures for us all to see. But for the most part of his life, he did what was right. Asa did right. And that's what I want us to talk about this morning. In this text, we see that God says of King Asa, he has it written down in the Bible for all of us to read, that King Asa did what was right in the sight of the Lord. Now, I believe that as children of God, as those who have been drawn to the Holy Spirit, God has revealed to us that we're sinners. We have repented of our sins. We have placed our faith in Jesus Christ alone. We've been made new in Christ Jesus. We are the saints of God, those who have been saved by the grace of God, that we desire to do what's right in the eyes of the Lord. And if there was something written about our life, as there was about the kings of Israel and Judah, we would want it to say of our life that Matt did that which was right in the sight of the Lord, or Gary did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. That's what we would want to be said of our lives. And that's good and that's right. That's what we should desire, is to do what's right in the sight of the Lord. To do that thing that is good. To do what's right. And to do what's right in the sight of the Lord is to do what's pleasing in the sight of the Lord. But there are some things we see in this text that it shows us what doing right looked like. What does it mean to do what's right? You know, we all have our opinions of what right and wrong can be sometimes. I may think to go this way or to do make this decision is right, and you may say that's wrong. And you may say that doing this is right, and I may say that's wrong. But what we know is we do have something that's certain and something that's true, and that's the Word of God. Now, there are many things. We live in a world today that teaches this, that truth is relative. That means anything you want to believe can be true. And anything I want to believe can be true. Truth is relative. Truth is whatever you make it. But we know, according to the Word of God, that truth is not relative. Truth is definite. Truth is sure. Truth is firm. And truth is found in the Word of God, the unchangeable truth of God. And we see in this text that Asa did some things in this text that we're going to see that was considered the right thing to do. And that's what we're going to look at. First of all, we see that he had to exclude some things from his life and his country. That's the first thing he did that was right. It tells us in verse 2, Asa did what was good and right in the eyes of the Lord. He took away, so we see some subtraction here. He took away the foreign altars and the high places and broke down the pillars and cut down the Asherim and commanded Judah to seek the Lord and all this. And then in verse 5 it says, he also took all of them. He also took out of all the cities of Judah the high places and the incense altars. So we see that he took some things away from Judah. They repented of some things. And so if we're going to do what's right in the sight of the Lord, if we want to live a life that is considered pleasing in the eyes of God, and that which is right in the eyes of God, we're going to have to set some things out of our life. Now we know we do this at salvation. We know that at salvation, when we come to Christ, that we must repent of our sins. We must turn from our sins. And that's not just this sin or that sin or some particular sin altogether. It is all of our sins. The idea of sin, the thought of sin, our love for sin, our sin nature. We are saying, God, I walk the wrong way. I do the wrong thing. I make the wrong decisions. I am a sinner, not only by the choices that I make, but by birth. I am a sinner. From birth, I'm a sinner. And God, I repent from my sins. I turn away from my sins. So we do that at salvation. But repentance for the believer does not stop at salvation. It's important to understand this, that we don't stop asking God to forgive us after salvation. This is a lifelong process for us. That every time we do something that is wrong, and yes, even though we're Christians, we do wrong. Even though we've been saved, we still make mistakes. Even though that we have been bought by the blood of Christ, and when God sees us, He sees the blood of His Son. He sees His Son's righteousness upon us. We still sin. And what do we do when we sin? Well, the Bible tells us that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So what Asa did here is he examined his nation. His father, Abijah, had done some good things. But what he didn't do is he didn't clear his nation from idols. And Asa said, you know what? We serve God. We serve the God of the Bible. We serve Jehovah, Yahweh, and that's who we need to serve alone. So if we're going to rightly and effectively serve God, we're going to have to remove ourselves from our idols. We're going to have to put away the strange gods. We're going to have to put away the altars of incense that are burned for other gods. So that's the first thing he does to set reforms in his nation. He sets out a decree and says, we only will serve God. Not the God that you make him to be. We serve God. There is different ways that we may serve other gods. Now, we don't bow before an altar. We don't bow before an idol and worship him. That's not what we do. I hope nobody does that. However, there are other ways that we serve other gods. We allow things to get in the place of God sometimes. We choose other things ahead of God. Sometimes those are bad things. Sometimes we choose to entertain ourselves with things that we shouldn't be entertaining ourselves with ahead of serving God and worshiping God. That's things, when wrong things that we try to put in the place of God. But sometimes we try to put good things in the place of God. What do I mean by that? Our family is a good thing. Our family isn't a vice. It's not taboo. It's not something that's sinful. We're supposed to love our family. We're supposed to keep our family very high on our priority list. But we're not to please our family first. First, it's God. Overall. And so when I try to put my family ahead of God, that's a good thing, family, but I'm trying to put it in the place of God, and I'm giving attention to it before I am my spiritual life and my relationship with the Lord. So sometimes we choose what's good over what's best. Our family is good. Our jobs are good. Our friendships are good. But when you try to put that which is good above that which is best, which is the Lord, that's an idol. And so these are different ways that we will serve other idols, and we must put these out of our life. We must repent. We must confess. We must make sure that we are putting God first in all that we do. That is very important. That's what Asa saw that was so important for the children of Israel to do, was to put away the strange gods, to put away the idols, to repent. We must seek a life of repentance. Repentance, sometimes we view it as a negative thing. I need to repent. This is so bad. Well, yes, the sin is bad, but repentance is grace. If God did not allow us to repent, then that wouldn't be a good thing. That would be a negative thing for us. So God has given us the gift of repentance so that we can have grace and we can have mercy and we can have favor with God. And so relationship can be restored between us and God. So God gave us repentance. So the first thing that King Asa did is he had to exclude some things. But then number two, we find he had to embrace some things. Notice in verse 4. They've put away the strange gods. They've taken down the altars and the pillars and all of these things that relate to worshiping other gods. And the verse 4 says, and he commanded Judah two things. To seek the Lord, the God of their fathers, and to keep the law and the commandment. This is what so not only did they have to exclude some things, they had to embrace some things, some commandments, some rules, if you will. First of all, that they must seek the Lord. Now the Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. So what does it mean to seek God, first of all? What does it mean to seek God first? Does this mean, okay, we have a list of priorities, and God goes at the top, family goes second, other relationships goes there, and then we put ourselves. Are we categorizing these things? I think to seek the Lord first is more than that. Seeking the Lord first is more than just putting God first and something else second, third, and fourth. To seek ye first the kingdom of God is to seek it most. As I'm spending time in it with my family and enjoying my family, as I'm working my job, as I'm doing the things on a daily basis that I'm supposed to do, I am seeking first the kingdom of God. I'm putting God first. I am seeking God most. He is the desire of my heart. He is what's precious to me. And if I'm seeking God in the way I should be seeking God, if I'm seeking God first, if I'm putting God first, seeking Him most in my life, then I can effectively and rightly love my family. I can effectively and rightly work my job. I can effectively and rightly do the other things in my life that I set out to do, because we understand that it's our vertical relationship with God that is important, and that's what feeds and enables and empowers our vertical relationships with others. Seek you first the kingdom of God. That's why the Bible tells us in the two great commandments, first is what? To love the Lord your God with all of your heart, soul, mind, and strength. What's the second that's like unto it? Love your neighbor as yourself. First we are to love God. First we seek God. First we put God first. And then we can rightly love others and neighbors as ourselves. So here's what Asa told the people of Judah to do. Seek the Lord. To seek the Lord is living the Christian life. To seek the Lord is doing those things that we're supposed to be doing. To seek the Lord is seeking a loving relationship with Him. It's one thing to have a certain type of relationship with God. Sometimes we try to have the relationship with God that we have with our grocery stores. I have a consumer relationship with Walmart. I have a consumer relationship with Walmart. I need something, so I go to Walmart or whatever the store of your choice is. And if Walmart has the thing that I'm looking for, that's a plus. But also, if they have the thing I'm looking for at the price that's good for me, that's another plus. And then if I get serviced with a smile, hey, that's just the cherry on top, right? That's a consumer relationship. Now, if Walmart don't have the thing I'm looking for, I'm going to go somewhere else. If Walmart has the thing I'm looking for, yet they don't have it at the right price, someone else has a better price, I'm going to go somewhere else. That's a consumer relationship. We don't have a consumer relationship with, say, our kids. You know, I sit down with Bryce and I say, you know what? You didn't clean your room today. I think I'm going to go find another son. You know, you didn't, you talk back to me. I think I'm going to look somewhere else for a better relationship than what I have with you. I have a consumer relationship with the store. I don't have a consumer relationship with my son. I have a covenanted relationship, a personal relationship. That's the relationship we have with God. Sometimes we seek the Lord and live the Christian life like he's Walmart. God, if you bless me, oh, I'm going to be in church this Sunday. If you do good in my life, I'm gonna do good for you. But when God doesn't bless us in the way we think he ought to, we might miss Sunday. We might not have a prayer life like we're supposed to. We might not read our Bible like we're supposed to. We're not supposed to have a consumer relationship with God. We're supposed to have a committed covenant relationship with God where there is nothing that stops it. There's nothing that decreases it. There's nothing that makes it go down or makes it go away. We are committed to God no matter what. That's the relation because he is committed to us. So Asa told the people to seek God. And then he said, number two, you need to embrace seeking God. Now you need to embrace keeping his commandments. This is the part we don't like sometimes. And sometimes we can refer to a version of this as legalism. We have to do this, 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 and this to please God. That's not what the scriptures say. But we are to keep his commandments and to do his work. You see, we don't keep his commandments in order to gain his favor. That's important to understand. That's key in understanding that I'm not going to love my neighbor in order so God will love me. That's works for salvation. I'm not going to not lie so God will love me. I'm not going to not bear false witness against my neighbor so God will love me. I'm not going to not murder someone so God will love me. That's works for salvation, doing things in order to get something from God. That's not why we keep his commandments. But why do we keep his commandments? We keep his commandments and we do his commandments because he has loved us. It's not something that we're doing working out so God will give us grace. It's God has given us grace, so therefore I love him, so I'm going to keep his commandments. I'm going to enjoy. You see, there's a difference. If you're trying to work for your salvation or work for God's favor, you're not necessarily enjoying the works that you're doing. It's a labor. But if I am doing something for God because of what he's done for me, that is a labor of love. And I enjoy doing those things for the Lord. I enjoy keeping his commandments. I enjoy obeying and being obedient to him. So in pleasing God, we're going to have to put some things away and exclude some things. But also in pleasing God and doing what's right in the sight of the Lord, we're going to have to embrace some things like seeking the Lord and keeping his commandments. But it doesn't stop there. We see that also he expanded some things. He expanded some things. Verse 5. Verse 6. He built fortified cities in Judah, for the land had rest. He had no war in those years, for the Lord had given him peace. For about 10 years, because they had been seeking the Lord, there was no wars that Judah was fighting. He said to Judah, let us build these cities and surround them with walls. There's the wall. And towers, gates, and bars. The land is ours because we have sought the Lord our God. We have sought him, and he has given us peace on every side, so they built and prospered. So, in doing what's right, they also had to expand some things. They had walls that had been crumbling, so they had to repair them. They had buildings and infrastructure that was old and decaying, so they went in and they made them stronger and made them better. That's what they had to do. Now, that was important for them. They wanted to present good things. They wanted to look well, and they wanted God to be able to look upon what he had given them and know that they were good stewards of it. So they had to expand some things. In the Christ life, we are always and constantly in a building project. I'm not talking about building new physical buildings, though sometimes we do that, and that's a good thing when that's needed. However, that's not what I'm referring to here. This is spiritual things. Sometimes, over time, our prayer life begins to crumble. It's not as strong as it used to be. It's not as fervent as it used to be. It's not as passionate as it used to be. And we need to build and expand upon it. Sometimes our life in the Word of God, our reading, our Bible study, we may miss a few days here and there. In fact, we may miss a few weeks or months here and there. And before long, we know that the only time we even touch this thing is when we go to church. That's it. So we need to be expanding our Bible study. We need to be expanding and building upon, because we have a good foundation. It's the Word of God. It's our prayer life. And so we need to be building upon these things. And it should be something that we desire to do as Christians. We should want our prayer life to be flourishing. We should want our Bible study life to be growing. You know, the old children's song, "He's Still Working on Me," that's very relevant for us today. We need to understand that He is constantly working on us. He's building on us. He's adding to us. Because we are being sanctified and being made more like Christ every day. So at salvation, He began the work. He justified us. And then we moved in the process of sanctification, where He's building, He's adding, He's growing. Sometimes it's at a slower rate than others, but that's okay. You might not be on the same path as others, but we are all being sanctified, and we're all going to the same place, the end of our salvation, which begins at justification, it moves into sanctification, and it ends in glorification, which is being perfected and made like Christ. So we are all on this path. God is building, God is adding, and we must see areas in our life that needs work. I wonder if there'd be anybody in here who would say, "Brother Matt, you can skip this part of the message for me. I don't need it because I'm perfect. I'm where I need to be. I don't need to add anything to my life. My family life is where it needs to be. My Bible study life couldn't get any better. My prayer life, if I spent any more time praying, I wouldn't get anything else done. I'm good." I dare say anybody would agree to that statement, those statements, right? We know that we need work. We know that we need to build and expand in these areas. But this isn't something that I'm legalistically telling you, "Hey, you need to do better on this." This should be something that flows from our hearts that we desire to do, and we want to do more. That's why I've tried to make reading through the Bible in the year available to you. We have Sunday school. We have discipleship in the evenings. We have time to come and hear the Word of God. We need to be constantly expanding our relationships with the Lord, because we need to be building until He comes. Jesus said, "Occupy until I come." Dude, we need to be working for the Lord. We need to be building our relationship with Him. And we know it's all by grace. We know it's by grace that this takes place. But we need to be seeing what God can do in our lives, expanding some things. Then we see, fourth, we need to be equipping ourselves and others. Notice verse 8. "And Asa had an army of 300,000 from Judah, armed with large shields and spears, and 280,000 men, shields and from Benjamin, that carried shields and drew bows. All were mighty men of valor." You know what Asa did? He began to train more people. He began to train more people. This is equipping the believers. Now, we need to see in our own selves, brethren, we need, and sisters in Christ, we need to see in our own selves that we need discipleship. We need discipleship. See, one of the flaws of a lot of pastors and Christians and churches is that we put a lot of emphasis into evangelism, but we never complete the work of evangelism. What do I mean by completing the work of evangelism? Evangelism is not full evangelism if we haven't done discipleship. See, we need to bring people to Christ. We need to show them the gospel. We need to preach the gospel of Christ to them. But the Great Commission tells us, go into the world and preach the gospel and teach them. Teach them to observe everything I've commanded you. That's discipleship. We need to be training others to live for Christ. We need to be equipping ourselves. Look for Bible studies. Look for more tools that grows your faith and grows your knowledge of the Word of God. And then seek how you can pour into the lives of others. You see, the Christian life is not about ourselves. It's never about ourselves. Me, myself, I, the Christ life is never about that. It always has the vision of seeing others brought to Christ, being perfected in Christ, maturing in Christ, pouring into others. Chunky Baptist Church was not planted however many years ago so that a few people could come in and have all their needs met. That's not why Chunky Baptist was planted. That's not why we're a church. We're a church to invest, which is time, prayers, money, and all of the above, into the community for reaching them for Christ and showing them and teaching them how to live the Christ life. That's what God's called us to do. It's not about ourselves. It's about others. It's about others. So we need to be equipping ourselves and others in the Christ life. Asa saw the need that they needed to train more people. We need to train more people. I understand that every church isn't going to be a mega church. That's simple. I understand that. But it is God's will to grow every church. Now, our growth might not look like another church's growth, but there still should be growth. Spiritual growth is most important. It's important. Growing from the inside, but then expanding, reaching out, reaching our community, reaching others with the gospel. That is what we've been called to do, and we must be equipping others for Christ. One last point I want to make from this text. We didn't read verses 9 to the end of the chapter, but in verses 9 to the end of the chapter, it tells us a story that a king came up against Judah. And this king had 1 million troops. And they were going to destroy Judah. They were going to completely obliterate, if that's even the right word, if I use that right. They're going to destroy Judah. What happens here? We see that sometimes we need to be the example of dependence on God. We see that this nation came up against Judah. They were going to destroy them. Judah didn't have a chance. So here's what King Asa did. He brings this to God. He lays down this need before God. And he makes a statement in our text that in verse... Look in verse 11 of chapter 14. Asa cried to the Lord his God, O Lord, there is none like you to help between the mighty and the weak. And here's a statement. Help us, O Lord our God, for we rely on you. We rely on you. He was an example to his nation of dependence and reliance on God. And that's what we need to be. Long story short, God won the battle for him. God defeated. God utterly defeated the other nation. But Asa was an example to his people of depending on God. Now, there are things we go through in this life that is like what Asa went through. It might not be an army of 1 million people has come up against us, but it's a big thing for us. It may be health problems. It may be financial issues. It may be whatever, family problems. But we go through things sometimes, maybe a death of a loved one, that someone else says, how in the world could you go through? I couldn't go through that. How do you go through that? If we will be an example of dependence and reliance on God, that will show others how to do that. And that is pleasing in the sight of God. That is right. That is good. You see, if we go through a bad situation and we say, I deny God, I'm turning away from God, God didn't love me and God didn't help me when I went through this bad situation, so I'm not going to love God. That's not a good example of dependence on God. That's an example of a quitter, of weakness. But through the power of the gospel, through the Holy Spirit, we as Christians, when we go through the hard times of life, when we go through those things that we feel like, how could I possibly go through that? And we remain firm, we remain steady, we depend on God. That's an example. Our faith has been an example. And God uses that. God uses that to show others the good way, the Christ life. what we're supposed to be. Whether it's a diagnosis of cancer, whether it's a losing a family member, whatever it may be, stand firm. Be an example. We have to exclude some things from our life. We have to repent. We have to embrace some things in our life. We have to expand areas in our life that need expanding and equip others for the cause of Christ. But we must be an example. And our greatest example, I want to tie this back into the gospel, our greatest example is Christ. Christ, who bore the greatest burden. And in the midst of it, he said, "Father, forgive them," those who were harming him. "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He was an example for us. And we have been called to walk in his steps. That's our calling today. So let's do what's right in the sight of the Lord. You may be here this morning and you may not be saved. You may not have a clue what we've been talking about because you've never trusted Christ. Well, you can do that today. His arms are extended. He's calling. You can come to Christ. But today, if you see areas in your life where you need to do better, why don't we commit to Christ that we'll do whatever it takes to please Him? Not because we've just been commanded to and we have to do it, but because we love Him and we want to do it. Father, we come before You this morning in the precious name of the Lord Jesus. And Father, we thank You for loving us. We thank You for Your mercy. Father, we thank You for forgiving us and loving us when we need Your forgiveness. God, if You wanted to, You could blot us off the face of this earth anytime we made a mistake, but You don't. You show mercy to us, and we thank You, Father. Help us to show that same mercy and love to others. Help us to do what's right in Your sight. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.